Hi, everyone. It's Eliot Jacobson here with you again today. And I have the pleasure of speaking with my nephew, Ruben Schaer. I'm in Santa Barbara, California, and Ruben is in Switzerland. We are having very different experiences of the planet right now, but we share so many common views about what's going on and what the future is going to bring. And I always enjoy chatting with you, Ruben. So glad you're here today, and welcome.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me again. I really enjoy our conversations as well.
So I'm just going to dive right in.
Go for it.
Dive right into this thing, because last time we ended right at the end, right, with this amazing concept of hacking humans. And I was just wondering if you can maybe talk a little bit about what that is, hacking humans, before we sort of ask, like, how is it being done? What does it actually mean to hack a human?
Right. Very interesting. I think in terms of hacking humans, that topic can be separated from the topic of AI, because it's been going on for a long time. You know, con men are a great example. You know, they figure out how to, say, gain somebody's trust and take advantage of them. And they learn that through experience and through other people that teach them to do these kind of things. And if people can do that, and they can get really good at it, just with the human experience of one lifetime, what happens if you have an AI and you train it with, you know, millions of hours of sales calls and similar things, successful and unsuccessful, and those AIs might very quickly learn exactly how to say the right things to specific to a target audience, a demographic, or even an individual person if they have really good tailored information. And you add to that, I mean, that's just the theory of, well, okay, now you have a really good AI salesman, great. But as we talked about last time, what happens when you take that and you combine it with the voice synthesis? So what if somebody calls you and it's your boss, but it's not your boss, and he asks you to do something? You know, it's like in the next level of phishing, essentially, in a way.
Right. So what I'm thinking about just in terms of hacking humans is marketing, the entire subject of marketing. And when you say it predates AI, I mean, it certainly does. And as long as products have been sold, as long as there's been capitalism, as long as there's been profit, right, there's been this tendency to exaggerate claims and to use psychological tools that have been better understood over time. You know, there used to be this idea that there were subliminal messages, and then there's, you know, the famous case where Betty Crocker there had a cake mix, and they figured that all you had to do was ask the housewife to add an egg, and that would make her, because she felt like she could participate. I mean, there's been all these sort of breakthroughs in understanding our psychological makeup for selling products. And so I think hacking humans, for me, is just another way of saying marketing. You know, how can we manipulate behavior towards an end that is increases the probability of us are achieving our goal, right?
Yeah.
And that can be political marketing or product marketing, or if you like, environmental marketing, or, you know, could be marketing for how you get employees to want to work for you, right? So it's a huge spectrum of hacking that's out there. And so my question is, what is AI? Why is AI better than anything we've ever done before as far as this ability to hack us? We understand it's been around a long time. What is it? What gives AI the leg up here?
I think we have to, I want to make something clear. When I'm talking about AI and hacking humans, I'm talking about the potential for that. And I think, as you like to talk in probabilities, I think it's not a question of if, it's a question of when. I don't know if it's going to be prevalent a year from now, maybe, maybe not. So right now, I don't think there is like an official field-wide science for hacking humans with AI, but I can see avenues how that could happen. And I think there's the obvious commercial application is sales calls, call centers, tech support, all those kind of things. And I think I just recently saw a study where they were doing like telemedicine, and patients were interacting with real doctors and fake doctors or AI doctors. And when they scored them about how they made them feel, how personable they were, et cetera, the AI outperformed the doctors every time. So they already figured out how to talk to humans and make humans feel at ease and comfortable. And that's not right. That easy to do. You have highly trained professionals in their jobs that are not able to do that.
Yeah.
So
one of the things that I've always thought, and AI is the perfect sort of platform for this, is that people have long been interested in sort of classifying personality types. And, you know, one of the ancient tools is astrology, right? So Capricorns are, you know, this, and Aries are that, and Leos are this, right? And so you try and classify personalities, and they use these very coarse tools. Of course, the whole subject's meaningless, but doesn't mean that the fundamental idea isn't valid. How can we create classifications of personalities and humans? And then we have these personality tests, right? These like four personality tests, and you get an NLTP or whatever the classification system is. But what has actually happened with masses of data that's out there is that you and I, are being micro-classified with incredibly specific, you know, huge databases on us, from our web searches to our interactions on social media to the products we bought online. You know, our digital trail is huge.
Yeah.
And, you know, that allowed, for example, the 2016 US election to be essentially hacked, right?
Yeah.
We weren't at the level of AI yet, but they had classified exactly the micro targets on social media, right?
Yeah.
For certain disinformation.
They exploited a vulnerability, essentially.
Right. For certain disinformation, right? That said, who are the people who are still possibly we could change their minds, and what disinformation is most likely to affect that, right? So that was a massive hack that had huge long-term ramifications for the planet. And so where are we today compared to 2016 with that kind of threat? I know I'm asking you questions you may not have thought about at all, but
No. I just realized that when I was thinking about hacking humans on a very individual level, you know, what would happen, you know, sort of more like a confidence man would.
Right.
But on a larger level, and this goes more into the whole post-reality situation that we have going on, you could very well, if you think about like how how much of our information these days comes from digital media, and what if suddenly your phone was getting essentially fake data streams, in the sense of like if AI generation gets good enough, and it's on its way there, to generate content. I mean, the entire thing with a person talking in a script, and you can't tell the difference between this and something that we would consider authentic today. You could conceivably take the whole concept of information bubble to the next level, and effectively have people truly live in parallel realities, just you know, that if you're not going to know, are you going to see the same thing on CNN that your neighbors see on CNN?
So it really gets that specific. I mean, it already is that way with our news feeds online, right? They're highly tailored to our history. And I mean, the whole point of that is we're just trying to prolong eyeball time on that website or that social media app, right? The question is, how long can we get the person to interact with us? Because the longer they interact, the more we can put our information, if they're advertising or whatever our agenda is. So, you know, I am thinking that we're moving away from TV, and maybe I'm misinformed about that. My TV watching has gone to almost zero. And it's not for want of good programs. It's because I can't stand the advertisements, the other parts of it that are just so aggravating. And so I go in search of media, you know, very specific media online. But you know, I think the thing about AI that, you know, that I really don't know is the biggest concerns, the biggest problems out there that are coming our way, the catastrophe, the AI, what are the worst case scenarios for this hacking that you see?
So I've been thinking about this. I'm not sure that answering that question is relevant to the larger question or the larger situation, because what I'm seeing, or puzzling things together, while it is interesting to take these myopic views and say like, oh, what could this technology mean in this specific instance and how could this go really wrong? It's really interesting, but I think the problem is much, much bigger than that. And AI is just a small part of what's coming. And I think I'm going to make a prediction here as somebody that has no background in economics or anything like that. I think 2024 is going to be the most volatile year the markets ever have seen in human history. And I say that because I see the confluence of a lot of economic things and political things coming together. And one of the things, and that's why I see AI really messing with us even before we talk about taking over jobs and stuff like that, is right now, all the AI stuff is really ad hoc. And while companies are using it more on an individual level in terms of, you know, individual employees, unless they already have good tools to integrate into their workflows and policies. But I think most companies right now that are not tech companies, that are completely different businesses, might be looking at this technology, testing things out, because towards the end of the year of 2023, at their earnings calls and shareholder meetings, they're going to say, hey, can you tell us about how your company is going to use AI to boost profits? Because it seems like your adversaries, your competitors are going to be doing that. So what's your plan? And so basically any company is that has the budget and foresight is going to be trying to get things going. But there's no real precedent. There's no here's how you do it. I bet there's going to be hundreds or thousands of consulting companies that are going to spring up, because the companies are going to be looking for who can tell us how to use this technology to save money or boost profits. And so right now what we're seeing is really sort of this AI spring. But in 2024, when all the companies basically are saying, this is our AI plan, and this is how we're going to be using AI to boost profits and savings, that's when it's really going to hit. And the thing is, now, if you are an investor and this company comes out and says, well, we think we can boost profits by X amount, how are you able to verify that? There's no precedent. There's no guidebook. There's nobody. No company is going to be able to make reliable predictions about how well this is going to work out. And so what is the stock market going to do? Like you look at past performance and market and the general market situation, and you try to make your best guess in terms of what you think is going to turn out well and what's not going to turn out well. And now suddenly nobody has a playbook to be able to. So where are you going to put your money? Like how you have no idea how is that even going to work? And then you add that, and that's only the investment part. That's only the shareholders, companies, what are we going to do in 2024 moving forward part. We're not even talking about the social component of people's jobs disappearing. And even there, it shouldn't be this myopic view of, oh, maybe artists are going to have a hard time with this, or maybe people working in an office doing no, it doesn't matter. It's going to be everything. Like I was talking earlier before we started recording about me and my nerd projects, where like I built like a lithium ion charge circuit using just a single operational amplifier that both does the charging and the over voltage and under voltage cutoff. And it was really neat. The thing is, I worked on that for a few days, figuring stuff out and optimizing the circuit. And a year from now, I could probably just ask an AI to, I want a circuit that does X. And now I'm not only losing potentially income, because now this work can be done by somebody else just as well. I'm also losing a source of joy, because now it's like, well, what's the point? Like why would I spend a few days optimizing this one circuit and, you know, learning new things and feeling excited about it and proud, and I can just type a prompt and so, does everything for me.
Yeah. I wonder how many people are already using AI for simple tasks out there. Like I will confess, if I need to write a letter, an email to someone, right? I give AI very specific instructions. I describe exactly who I am, who the person is, what the email has to, the content, mm-hmm. How long it should be, and so on. And it generates one for me that I can then edit in just a couple minutes to be exactly what I want to say. I can have it write a little 5-minute speech for a memorial that I'm going to go to for a person, right? I've had it write poetry. I've had it, I'm using AI routinely now in my day-to-day life, right? And it is making a whole bunch of stuff easier for me. I've also asked AI questions like, write a computer program to find the house edge in Baccarat, for example. And it comes up with a computer program that works, but essentially what it does is it puts a static variable in there that has the house edge, and then it prints it out, right? It has a print command, which is, you know, at some level it's correct because it went online and it looked up the edge and it had a program that does it, but it's so absurdly wrong, right? In any sort of usable level. And so I have my own tests that I'm conducting on it to sort of keep track of where it is. But yeah, I think that we're coming to that critical point very, very soon. And it's going to be interesting to see how these next few generations develop. You know, I know that there's already a huge influx on Amazon, for example, of books written by AI, that they're now, you know, the largest single generator of new material, right, on self-published is AI generated. So what do you do with that when people are essentially saying, here's the book I wrote, but it's, you know... But
how is that different from a ghostwriter?
Well, I mean, on my website, climatecasino.net, you instructed AI to write an essay about climate change, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And we actually, I mean, it was so good that we actually had Sam Mitchell read it, right? In one of his broadcasts. I mean, it's already that good, right? And that was already months ago and has gone through so much training. I would be, just because I'm kind of a nihilist, I'd be overjoyed to see the stock markets crash tomorrow. You know, the sooner the better, in my opinion. So if AI is one of the precipitators of economic collapse, you know, all right, it's taken all the jobs. People don't know how to evaluate the worth of a company anymore because of the AI usage in the company. Obviously there's a lot of questions there.
This is something that a lot of content creators are very sort of like thinking and talking about. If there was, and there probably will be in the not so distant future, you have the possibility to basically, the same way that you're using it for emails right now, use it for videos. Let's say you write a number of topics and you say, like, I would like to generate a video with my likeness and my voice. I'm going to be talking in this mood. These are the topics I want you to talk about. These are my points that I want you to make, create the video and upload.
Wow.
Like,
yeah, that's pretty impressive.
I mean, that's where we're headed. So now can you, I would argue in that case, you could probably be held liable for, you know, what you're saying, because it's still you, like you're setting everything up. And if your AI model ends
up saying, as long as I'm the authenticator of the request.
Right. Right. You could say, well, or you would have to like verify it, like watch the video before you upload it to make sure that there's no.
So you're bridging on this idea of deep fakes, right? Yep. It's essentially what you're getting to. The idea that we're getting to the point where we can fake videos that are essentially no longer human detectable fakes, right? There's no analytical tools.
Is it still fake at that point? Because right now we talk about, oh, deep fakes, you know, it's like this other person's body and this other person's head. I mean, that's what they were talking about 6-7 years ago.
Right.
But if you created it and it's your likeness and it's indistinguishable from you, and the only thing that just, you know, that makes it different is that that video never happened in reality. It only happened, you know, it was only generated virtually. Does that, I don't know, is that still fake?
Yeah.
I mean, is it?
Okay, the question, now you're getting outside my, but if we're going to talk about what is reality or is there a...
But this is what it really comes down to. Because, yeah. I mean, we consume so much of our information and our reality lives in this virtual world today. And we have for a very long time, it's always been sort of a reflection of the analog world. And we just, if you look at a mirror, like you don't wonder, is the mirror showing you a fake picture? You would never second guess that the mirror, the image you're seeing is somehow not real.
Right.
But what if the mirror isn't a mirror? What if it's a screen with a camera? And suddenly, you know, just as it is today, and you can do digital touch-ups and all that. But that also means that you now, like, fundamentally are looking at something that is not a reflection of reality. It is a modification of reality, or even something that is completely new, but at the same time indistinguishable from reality. And what does that even mean if you consider that what we perceive as reality is only like this thing that our brain creates, this nonstop real-time simulation that lags half a second behind, trying to make sense of all our sensory inputs. So I mean, you could argue that if you are able to hack a person's analog perspective, is that now also not real anymore? I don't know. That's why I keep getting pulled back from the myopic perspective into much more fundamental issues. And I can't see how, with all the other things that are going on in terms of climate change and the rise and fall of authoritarianism and rise and fall, that's something that's one of the few positive things I'm sort of seeing happening right now in the world that I'm happy to talk about.
I don't see a lot of fall, I have to tell you. I see a lot of rise. I don't see much fall. You might be talking about the Greens, for example, in England, or Lula in Brazil, or, you know, Trump losing in the US, right? Those might all seem appropriate, you know, like victories for or falls, as you would say. But overall, I have to say that it doesn't feel that way to me. It feels like the damage has been done, and we're just maybe slowing the fall, but it's all fall right now. So I don't know. I speaking of that, if we could just change a little bit. So you're in Europe,
mm-hmm.
which does have some different things going on from other parts in the world. And I know Switzerland has not had the worst of it this year, but no. You're very close to some places that are really screwed right now. I mean, essentially from where you are to Spain and Portugal is about from where I am to Las Vegas. Is, you know, 500 miles, 800 kilometers, something.
No. From Switzerland over to Portugal, it's probably at least about 8,000 miles, something like
that. Okay.
It's not quite that.
So from here to Denver, Colorado, yeah. Which is a third of the way across the country.
Yeah.
Is about where you are. So you must have a different sense of things than other people, you know, who are reading this news. What is that like in Europe right now? What is the feeling about what's going on down in Spain and Portugal?
Honestly, I cannot answer that question confidently. Switzerland is very insulated. Insulated in the sense that we consume, so the general Swiss population mostly consumes, I would say, German media and Swiss media. And it's always hit or miss if they're going to be talking about things happening in the Iberian area. And I honestly barely even consume Swiss media. I listen to our radio, you know, when I'm driving my car and stuff like that, but that's about it. So I don't know if I can answer that question. Like, you know, I can't really tell you anything.
Well,
is there
any sort of general malaise that you feel, you know, among the Swiss where you are that is tangibly different than it was, you know, just last year or anything? Do you feel like any sort of growing anxiety, cultural anxiety or stress?
What I've noticed is that if I was talking about preparing for emergency situations about 10 years ago, or even 5 years ago, people in Switzerland would just, if they were polite, they would listen, but they wouldn't engage in the conversation or take it seriously. There was this, about 10 years ago, there was some Swiss minister in answering a press question who said, oh, he thought it would be a really good idea, in his opinion, if every family in Switzerland had 3 days worth of drinking potable water stored in their basement somewhere. And he got criticized for that. That was alarmism, and people shouldn't have to worry. And now it's very different. People's interest in, I would say generally people are more interested in security. They're more interested in, you know, sort of having solar and being somewhat energy independent, talking about the future in terms of, hey, we pretty much all agree things are going to get pretty bad. That's a lot more common now. And you don't have to be afraid of voicing those opinions. If anything, the really annoying thing is that everybody's thinking and feeling these things, but when you talk about it, there's no good solution, right? So people go and they engage in coping mechanisms, or, you know, sometimes I have one friend and sometimes I talk to him about these kind of things, and he kind of keeps making sort of excuses about, oh, that's not going to happen because this and this, and I just shake my head and be like, what are you talking about? And at the end of it, he just ends up saying, well, you know what, if the mushroom cloud comes, I'm gonna just be sitting on my front porch with a glass of wine and look off into the distance and said, that was pretty good. And I was thinking, that's not how it's going to end.
No.
Like, or maybe it will end there eventually. It's a possibility, I guess, but there's just going to be a lot of pain and suffering on the way to that point that is not going to be remedied by a glass of wine on the porch and the sunset.
Yeah, as if you could just enjoy a cool breeze and your wealth and your opportunities and your property and all of those things, you know, until the last moment. And, you know, it reminds me of, I mean, there's a famous saying, you know, people would joke when everybody was smoking cigarettes and getting cancer and stuff, they would say, well, I know it shortens my life, but it's the last couple of years anyway, when I wouldn't, you know, I'm not going to be very well anyway. So, you know, just as soon not have to live those years, right? No, it does not just that it shortens your life, but it degrades all quality of your life, you know, in every aspect. And that's an escalating, you know, sort of accelerating curve of being degraded. So, you know, we are so spoiled by this world right now with what we have access to, and everywhere we turn, and we take it all just like that's how it should be. You know, I, growing up for me, right, I, no internet, no cell phones, no computers, no, you know, just, we did have nuclear warfare and on the horizon, and DDT and rivers on fire and oil spills. And, you know, so it's a very different world when everybody has a $700 computer, you know, in their hand, and they're carrying it around, and they feel as if that's what life should be, right? We just have a long way to fall. But I mean, what about other things for you personally? Are you paying attention to the latest, you know, worldwide stuff that's going on with sea surface temperatures or El Nino or any of these sorts of things?
Oh yeah, yeah. I was going to ask you about the Sierra snowmelt and if that has begun for you guys yet, if that's something you're concerned about.
So for those people who may not know, our snowpack, we had these rains, essentially, we had the second highest rain ever recorded this year, in many parts the highest since records began in the 1800s, late 1800s, 1890 or so. There's parts of the Sierras that are 300% of normal snow. And so the concern is whether, so typically May begins the high snowmelt season. If we were to get, for example, a very warm El Nino rain this time of year, one of these atmospheric rivers, or to have a record heat in the, you know, there's all sorts of ways that this could just overwhelm our infrastructure. What's happened instead, and this has something to do with this cold blob of water right off the Pacific coast that's now going away, is that it stayed remarkably cool late into the year, and it's still cool, and it's like record cold. It's so, you know, and it's gone on and on and on, and it was like we kept thinking, like, when is this going to end? When are we going to finally be past this? And we're still not past it, right? So because of that, a lot of this snow is not melted, right? And they're even talking about there's going to be enough that it's not going to melt. It's going to last till next year, which would be, you know, in certain parts of first. So what could happen is that because it's not melting now, that if we get a huge heat wave in early June or late May or something like that, it'll all come down, you know, in just a huge wave. So we are really on the edge of a historic disaster. And it's all going to be whether, you know, how the weather changes as we go into summer, whether it's a gradual slow change that prolongs the melt over 4 to 6 weeks, or whether we get one of these monster heat waves that just melts all this stuff. So it's a to be seen. You know, we have this new lake that's in the sort of central southern area of the state that was drained long ago, I think in the 1930s, to make way for farmland, Tulare Lake, that is something like, I don't know, 130,000 square miles. It's some huge, huge lake, right? It's not a small area. And so all of this land that was farm belt is essentially gone. And so the effect on our already on California farming, which were the breadbasket for the country, has been devastating. So look, you know, we'll see what that does to prices of things. So, I mean, that's what's gone on for us this year. And this has nothing to do with sea surface temperatures being at record highs worldwide. This has to do with the fact that if you look at sea surface temperatures all over the planet, there's exactly two places where they're below average. And one is off the coast of California and the other is off the coast of Chile, right?
So one of them like 13 degrees over. I remember looking at that's somewhere on the east coast of Africa.
Yes. Just remarkable. And you know, we're today having a essentially category 4, maybe category 5 cyclone slam into, where is that, Bangladesh or Myanmar or somewhere, you know. So you know, it's the humanitarian crises are just beginning this year.
Vietnam just had what, 44-45 degrees a few days ago,
in Spain.
Centigrade. That's 125 or something.
Well, no, so 40.
110? 45?
I'll do it. So 40 is 104, 45 is 113.
Okay.
And, you know, they had the hottest temperature ever in Southeast Asia and Vietnam and Thailand, right? And so they got up to those temperatures of 45°C, you know, 113, 115-ish Fahrenheit. But the difference is that they have a huge humidity problem there.
Yeah, you know? I was looking at that.
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's not, I mean, they're tropical, right? So we're not talking about desert heat. If you've ever been to Southeast Asia, you can picture that in your mind.
We're talking about red bulb heat.
Those are jungles there, right? That's absolute jungle in that part of the world. So when you get temperatures of 45, which is about
45 at 100%. It's deadly.
Well, it's deadly. Yeah.
It kills you. Even like 36, I think, is already, they figured out that 36 is not safe.
Yeah. And, so the wet bulb is 35 at 100%.
Yeah.
But that just got lower. There was some research that just came out a couple weeks ago that said, so maybe that's what you were thinking about, that, that, you know, it's a question of what's absolutely not survivable. Right. And for how long? And I think they lowered it from like 35 to 33, you know, with 100% humidity. So essentially what it means is we will become heat stressed at lower than expected temperatures, even as temperatures are rising faster than expected. Right.
Yeah.
So, what's happening in Southeast Asia right now with these heat waves together with the rain coming, you know, to that part of the world. The monsoons are going to be starting up pretty soon. And, you know, there's other parts like British Columbia right now is having a record heat wave, right? BC, just the way they did in 2021 when, you know, Lytton burned down after days and days of, they got close to 50°C, close, like you say, 122 degrees is 50°C, right? And then it burned down. Canada. What?
In Canada.
Yeah, in Canada. Yeah, this happened in 2021. There was a heat dome, and there was 3 consecutive days that were each an all-time record Canadian temperature, not just, you know, this location or this day or this month, an all-time temperature anywhere ever in Canada. 3 consecutive days in this one province in Canada. And then the place where it actually peaked was this little town of Lytton, Canada, L-Y-T-T-O-N. And then the day after it peaked, they had a huge fire that came through and burned down the entire city. So it turns out that right now, today, if you want to look at sort of anomalous temperatures, so there's not going to be an all-time high, but it's going to be an all-time sort of high pressure dome for the day that's creating in a sort of relative way, this is equal to that event. And it's going on. So you can read about, and that's throughout northern the northwest part of Canada, all the way down through British Columbia, Northwest Territories. And, you know, it's going to be one of these phenomenal heat waves. That's a 1 in 1,000 year thing, right? So, and of course, Alberta has, you know, 100 forest fires going on right now. And that is, you know, there's way beyond anything they've ever had before, caused by lightning, you know, because of these storms that are coming through, these dry lightning storms. So, yeah, so a lot of stuff is going on right now. I personally am keeping track very closely of El Nino and the sea surface temperatures, just because I'm a numbers guy, you know, I like to keep the data, but what it's going to spell, you know, for the future of this year. And I mean, on top of AI, right? Yeah, for next year.
Yeah. That's the other reason why I was thinking about market volatility, because the El Nino event, if it happens, is going to be happening later this year, but that means it's going to be in full swing in 2024. And if it's going to, and, you know, the areas in Southeast Asia and other places, or that part of the world, they're really, really important to the global economy, because a lot of stuff is made there. They are also really important food producers in their area. And if suddenly there's going to be long stretches of the year where they are not able to work, where they are not able to produce food, and that just becoming a thing that just happens now every other year or something like that, what does that mean for trying to live a life there and have a future and have a family and like working and if you're dealing with both food and economic insecurity and in terms of like the international services that they provide, not just in terms of like manufacturing or clothing and garments and things like that, also there's a lot of remote telework that is being done. There's a lot of really talented graphic and video artists in Southeast Asia that do work over the internet for big American studios and stuff like that. So again, I think 2024 is gonna be an incredibly volatile year, because there's just so many things at play that all have the potential to have a big impact on a comprehensive impact on the economy. But it is really difficult to predict in what directions it's going to go and what the consequences are going to be and what the best strategies are to hedge against those risks. And so I don't know. I don't see how anybody's going to make good predictions for 2024.
Yeah, I've been making predictions every year so far, but, you know, I have my website, Climate Casino, where I make predictions, and then people get to vote on those if you follow me on Twitter. So, you know, for me, it's all predictions. The best predictions are over under predictions. You can say, what are the chances that something is over or under? So, for example, I think it would be reasonable to predict that 2024 will be the hottest year ever on the planet, right? Yeah. That the annual temperature for the planet will break the 1.21 Celsius gain over the 1850 to 1900 baseline recorded in 2016. I think it is reasonable to predict that ocean heat content will reach an all-time high, that, you know, there's going to be, that's the total heat absorbed by the ocean. That's, you know, absorbed due to the differences between incoming and outgoing solar radiation. And you can actually put a numerical guess on that based on trends, that CO2 and methane will reach all-time highs. You know, well, how high will they reach? So this year, for example, last October, I had a bet whether CO2 levels would reach 424 parts per million this year. That's my over-under, right? So on a day-to-day basis, many, many days have hit that mark. Whether it'll come out as the monthly, which is what the bet is based on, we'll have to see. So, you know, when you're predicting the future, I think that it's sort of a measure of how analytical you want to be. If you're going to talk about predicting the future, like, will there be a heat wave that kills 1 million people in India, right? Probably not, would be my guess. That was the opening scene, by the way, in a novel, a science fiction novel. So I use that as a...
You know, but a million people in... I mean, I was just thinking about... If you have... We were talking about the wet bulb temperature earlier, and that was one thing that came to mind is like, well, how do they, like, what do they test that on? Because I don't think that number is going to be the same for an 86-year-old and for a 24-year-old, or not, you know. And so I'm thinking, well, wait, a million dead in China? That's like one over
one, like one in a thousand.
Hundred. So yeah. That's one in one. One that, so I'm thinking, like, does their population have like more than 1%, one promille of the population in an age bracket and a health bracket that's at risk? I would guess so.
But it would have to be in the particular location where the heat also happens.
I think the question is, how broad is it geographically?
And that they don't have access to shelters, that the that the infrastructure, electricity, and so on. You know, so I think India is probably at risk more than any other place on the planet for a massive heat wave to create a mass humanitarian, you know, situation. And it looks like they're going to get through this year okay, because typically what happens is come late May, early June, the monsoon season starts. And even though you might say, oh, it should be hotter that time of year because it's summertime now, it's actually cools because of these rains. If the monsoons are delayed, that would be a huge, that could lead to a heat wave. If there, you know, certain meteorological conditions are met because of El Nino, that could create a heat wave. So we'll see. But, you know, for me, that's the benchmark of collapse at which you could say, okay, it started, is a massive heat wave somewhere on the planet, creating mass casualties, right? Yeah. And, you know, there's been persistent drought in the Horn of Africa that has had some impacts, you know, huge casualties. But it's not a specific, like, okay, a week ago, these people were alive and now they're dead kind of thing. When that one happens, things, you know, that's when it's getting real for the us, yeah. I think.
I mean, if it, I wonder, you know, talking about shelters and stuff like that. I'm just imagining what we are dealing with temperatures, worst case temperatures these days of like above 50 degrees C's in the worst.
Yeah,
like
easily, yeah.
455. But I feel like there's almost a tipping point, because I think like with full fan and everything in a dark room that's insulated, you can survive for some time. But what if it's, and eventually we're going to hit that, what if it's 60?
I actually have, I actually have 60 as a wager on Climate Casino. You know, when is 60 going to be reached somewhere on the planet?
Because you're going to have a time, if you have an area geographically that gets, you know, 60 degrees or more for an entire day, you might have a mass casualty event.
Oh, yeah. No, you certainly would. So right. For those who are, let me just
and in add, one day, not, you know, not like spread not right. out.
Yeah, not, no, not one day. Out. Absolutely.
One day, hundreds of thousands of people, maybe millions of people. And a health system, and of course it's going to be in a country that's vulnerable and that doesn't have good infrastructure and all that. And so,
yeah, for those temperatures, we're looking at most likely Northern Africa or the Middle East being the first place that happens. For those who are in the U.S., 60 is, I think, 140 degrees Fahrenheit. I think the highest temperature ever recorded on the planet is somewhere in the 133 range, 134. So, yeah, you're talking about roughly 3 or 4 Celsius hotter than any place has ever been before. Yeah, so I do have that. I mean, that's a great question, because that is, you know, there is a temperature, it doesn't matter if you had 0% humidity, beyond which you know, is not survivable. And not just that, you know, infrastructure would collapse. There's already was pictures going viral on Twitter of places in, I think it was Thailand, where the roads were melting from the recent heat wave. In other words, just the what they use for the road materials, they're very cheap, right? They're low quality pavement. It was just melting in when it was 110 degrees there, when it was, you know, 45 degrees. So if the infrastructure collapses, then, you know, the electric grid will collapse. You can't get air conditioning. You know, you can't find refuge. You can't go seek shelter because it's too hot to even go outside. So yeah, that one's coming as well. And that's, yeah. So unbelievable times are coming. And so when you say the rise and fall, yeah, I think we'll see. I mean, I'm just to go back to that point, because I guess I was curious and I didn't let you finish the thought, but where do you see the rise? We talked about the rise and fall of authoritarian, you know, where do you see the good things happening on the planet?
I'm not looking at individual elections or something. No, that's not true. I am looking at some individual things too, but in sort of a larger picture thought, you can look at all the different governments in the world also as competing systems. And if you look at sort of how long are they able to stay around? How well are they able to compete economically and politically, or cooperate economically and politically with other states? And consistently, democracies are outperforming autocracies. And that's just because in an autocracy, you have inherent inefficiencies and you have a huge issue with corruption. I mean, that's what Russia is dealing with right now, where basically their entire military bankrupted itself before the war because all the money that they were getting for maintaining and buying equipment was, or a lot of it was not actually used for that purpose. And so in a real world sense, even if an authoritarian state can portray an image to the outside of being big and powerful, they're dealing with a lot more inefficiencies. And you can have a state like North Korea, but that's really isolated, and they can only survive because other countries are actually, you know, still, you know, they're getting aid, essentially, whether that is legitimate aid or illicit aid. They if they have to actually compete fairly with the rest of the world, they wouldn't stand a chance. Or those countries have to, if they want to compete, they have to exploit their own workforce and their own population to provide cheap services to other economies that are more advanced. And so I'm starting to realize that as I'm getting older, that even though in the moment we might feel like everything is falling apart, if you look at it, most people, I'm not going to say most of them, but bad people eventually get what's coming to them. Eventually. It might take a generation, it might take two, but if you have in a democratic system that is working the way it is intended to work. And I think the American system was a really interesting situation or these last 6-7 years, because we didn't just watch the election getting hacked. We also, in a way, watched the American civic system getting hacked, especially with the stacking of the courts. I mean, the whole thing happening with the Supreme Court right now is kind of insane. But in the background, there are these mechanisms that are starting to be engaged slowly to, like, hey, we have to do this differently. And I would predict that 5 years from now, the way we elect Supreme Court justices, and if it isn't already changed, there's going to be legislation that is actively going to be considered and looked at to sort of get rid of those loopholes that can be exploited by malicious actors. And so on the one hand, we can say, oh my God, we just lost, talking about reproductive rights, you know, it's a huge backstep. But we're talking about events within a single human lifetime. You were alive when Roe v. Wade happened, and you were alive also when it got repealed.
Right.
And so in a historical sense, that's really not a lot of time. That's just like one,
right,
one half of a period. And my feeling is, if you have, not talking about the climate situation, not talking about all these other factors that are going to definitely be a fall, if you just look at the competing political structures and concepts, I do think that authoritarianism does not work for the long haul.
I've summarized what you're saying. There's a very famous little, it's a cute little quote. And I think it goes something like, reality has a liberal bias. So, you know,
reality has a reality bias.
Well, but it has a liberal bias. You know, reality has a liberal bias that liberals tend to work with facts, like there are homosexuals. There's nothing wrong with that. That's just a biological fact that, you know, we work with facts about climate change. We work with facts about political systems, and authoritarianism has to work on the opposite principle. You know, their media is evil, books are evil, you know, individuals are evil, and this sort of creating these artificial classifications of people as good versus evil, right? And so if you're just trying to work outside of a system that has this binary and is open to more complex, nuanced thought that requires, you know, evidence and reasoning and science, you know, reality has a liberal bias, right? So that's what I mean by that. And I think that, you know, that's kind of what what you were saying was larger than that, but that for me to have just condensed it that way. But I'm going to have to just apologize here. I don't mean to have the last word here. But yeah, as usual, fantastic having this conversation with you. Always enlightening to me, opens my eyes to a lot of different topics. And so it's great to have you as a friend and, of course, as a relative, and to be in communication with you in these shows that we've been doing together. So thank you.
Thank you for having me one more time, and I hope it's not the last time. I really enjoy having these interactions with you as well. It's very meaningful to me.
So stay on the line. I'm going to close the show now, and we'll just chat a little bit more. All right, everyone. All right. We'll see you later.
Take care. Bye.
Bye.